Hey friends, welcome to the YouTube channel Allowable Electronics. In this video, we will learn about the heatsinks, which are quite commonly used today in the electronic devices. So as its name suggests, this heatsink absorbs the heat which is generated by the electronic devices and then it transfers this heat to the surrounding. Now this surrounding could be either air, water or sometimes even oil. So these heatsinks are available in various sizes and shapes. But the purpose of every heatsink is to remove the heat from the components. And like I said, they are widely used in the electronic devices. So if we talk about the computer peripherals, then they are used in the graphics cards, CPU and sometimes even the RAM modules. So in a high performance RAM modules, they are used as a heat spreaders. And not only that, they are also used in the LED modules as well as in the electronic components like high power MOSFETs and the transistors. So as I said, the purpose of every heatsink is to remove the heat from the electronic devices so that they can be operated in the allowable temperature range. But then the question arises, why these electronic components get heated? So the answer is, if you see any electronic device, then not all the energy is converted into the useful work. For example, if you take the case of an LED, then only some fraction of applied power is getting converted into the light. And the remaining power is getting dissipated in the form of heat. And more technically speaking, every electronic device consists of finite number of resistors. And these resistors dissipates the power in the form of heat. Then if we talk about the processors, then it consists of millions and billions of tiny little transistors. And in this processor, even if all the transistors are not in use at once, still they consume some power. And this energy or power is getting dissipated in the form of heat. And the same is true with the other electronic components like diode and the transistors. And as we have seen in the previous videos, all the electronic components have some finite resistance. And the power which is getting dissipated across this equivalent resistor is converted into the heat. And due to this heat, the device temperature increases, which not only reduces the lifetime of the device, but sometimes it can even damage the device. And that is why it is quite important to maintain the device temperature within the acceptable range. And that is the reason the heat sinks are used with the electronic devices and particularly with those devices which generates the considerable amount of heat. So the heat sinks operation is based on the Fourier's law of heat. That means whenever the temperature gradient exists in the body, then heat transfers from the high temperature section to the low temperature section. And this heat can transfer in the three different ways. That means through conduction, convection and the radiation. So now let us see, whenever we connect the heat sink to the device, then how the heat transfer occurs. So as shown in the schematic, the heat sink is connected to the device. And this device transfers the heat to the heat sink via conduction. Now to maximize this heat transfer, the device and the heat sink should be in the proper contact. But even if you connect these two surfaces properly, then also at the microscopic level if you see, some air gap still remains between the two surfaces. And due to this air gap, the heat transfer between the two surfaces will get affected. So using the thermal compounds like heat sink compound, the air gap can be minimized. And due to that, the heat transfer between the device and the heat sink can be maximized. Now from the heat sink, the heat is transferred to the surrounding through the convection method, and a minor amount of heat is also transferred using the radiation method. So in this way, the heat is transferred from the device to the surrounding. Now the heat sink is designed in such a way that the surface area which is in the contact with the cooling medium can be maximized. So here the idea is that the contact area of the heat sink should be at least 10 to 20 times more than the surface area of the device, and that is why this fin type arrangement is used with these heat sinks. So the performance of this heat sink, that means how well it is able to transfer the heat, depends on the multiple parameters like the area of the heat sink, the fin density and the fin spacing. And it also depends on the material which is used for the construction of this heat sink. So usually either aluminium or copper is used for the construction of this heat sink. And then it also depends on the airflow. So speaking of the airflow, the heat sink can be classified in two categories. One is active heat sink and the second is passive heatsink. So in case of a passive heatsink, there is no mechanical moving part and the heat is transferred through the natural convection. While in case of the active heatsink, the heat is transferred using the forced convection, and for that the devices such as fan or blower is used. So due to the forced convection, this active heatsink can remove the heat more efficiently. So for the same heat transfer, the active heatsink requires the less space compared to the passive heatsink. But as it involves the mechanical moving part, so it requires the more maintenance compared to the passive heatsink. Now apart from this forced cooling using the fans, sometimes the vapor chambers are also used in many applications. So the vapor chamber heatsink is constructed from the sealed metal plates, and then it is filled with a small amount of fluid such as deionized water. So this water allows the heat to be rapidly dispersed away from the source. So whenever the heat is applied to this vapor chamber, then the fluid which is near the location immediately vaporizes, and then it fills the entire volume of the chamber. Now when this vapor comes into the contact with the cooler wall surfaces, then it condenses and releases the heat to the cooler wall surfaces. And this condensed fluid returns back to the heat source via capillary action. So this is all about the different types of heat sinks which are used with the electronic components. Now for any heat sink, how is it able to transfer the heat is defined using the thermal resistance. And this thermal resistance is defined in the unit of either degree centigrade per watt or degree Kelvin per watt. That means what is the rise in the temperature of particular device when we apply the 1 watt of power. And the thermal resistance of any heat sink should be as low as possible. So let's say for a 1 heat sink, if the thermal resistance is 5 degree centigrade per watt, then if a 5 watt of power is absorbed by the heat sink, then the temperature of the heat sink will rise by 25 degree centigrade. And if the ambient temperature is 25 degree centigrade, then the heat sink will be at a 50 degree centigrade. On the other end, if the thermal resistance of one heat sink is let's say 1 degree centigrade per watt, then if this heat sink absorbs the 5 watt of power, then the temperature of the heat sink will rise by 5 degree centigrade. And if the ambient temperature is at 25 degree centigrade, then the heat sink will be at a 30 degree centigrade. So clearly, the second heat sink, which has a thermal resistance of 1 degree centigrade per watt, can transfer the heat quite efficiently. And this type of calculations are very important for selecting the heatsink for the specific application. And if you want to know more about this type of calculations, then do let me know here. So I hope in this video you understood what is heatsink and the importance of the heatsink in the electronics. So if you have any question or suggestion, do let me know here in the comment section below. If you like this video, hit the like button and subscribe the channel for more such videos.